حياتنا منين لما بنتعب وحدك شايف تقدر تسند ما انت معين تقدر تسند ما انت معين.
Thank you, Emma. Thank you, Emma. Thank you. I have good news for you today. Since I came here, before I came here, maybe a couple of years ago, and since I came here, we have been helping so many Muslims to believe in Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. And this is the most exciting thing that God is giving me and Hala in our lives. And I am going to share with you today one topic from my book. Mike is fine. What's wrong with the mic? Oh, those technical things. We Egyptians don't care about, you know. I am talking and that's good enough. Okay. I am going to share with you one topic from the book that God guided me to write, Glad News, God Loves You, My Muslim Friend, which God has been using to help many Muslims become born-again Christian. And before I share the topic, I know that people will be surprised from the information I share, so I want you to have peace and rest assured that God has been using this information. So I'm going to ask my brother, I'm looking for his name. I try to remember it. Kafakal or... tell me your name, please. Kafakal. Can you help us hear Pastor Chuck Smith's testimony? I had an office at Calvary Chapel Costa Mesa for 15 years before we became a nonprofit ministry, and many Muslims came to the church and shook Pastor Chuck's hand and told him, thank you for the ministry. We were Muslims. We became Christians. And I want you to hear this testimony because I'm not going to have time to read to you that is the emails I get of Muslims coming to Christ. So. Thank you, Gail. Thank you, Gail. Gail is easy.
I have a coworker who I can consider somewhat of a friend who is Muslim. Uh-huh. And we talk here and there. I'm not as knowledgeable as I should be about the Bible. And I would love to be more knowledgeable and try to help him, mm-hmm. You know, because I'm concerned. But it's hard to answer some of his questions concerning the Old Testament and the New Testament. And I would love to know what to do, what kind of format to go through, whether we're giving him a book. I had given him a Bible.
Uh-huh.
So I don't know, you know, hopefully he still has that in his house.
Okay, we do have a fellow here in our church who is an Egyptian, and he probably knows more about the Muslim faith than what they know.
That's me.
He's very, very versed in the Muslim religion. And he's written a book titled, God Loves You, My Muslim Friend. And many Muslims have been converted after reading this book. So I would suggest that if you want to give your friend something that would really help him, because it takes the Muslim beliefs and it sort of takes the Bible and sort of shows comparisons and so forth. And I would highly recommend that you give him this book by Samy Tanahgo on God Loves You, My Muslim Friend.
Okay, let's start our adventure. So the Quran gave Jesus three distinguished and significant titles. The first one is the Quran said Jesus Christ is the Messiah at least 11 times. So we tell Muslims, wow, the Quran written in Arabic, and we tell Muslims the Messiah is not an Arabic word. It's a Hebrew word. What does the Messiah mean? Well, there is no explanation to this title in the Quran. We tell Muslims, oh, I have good news for you. We have many major prophecies written about the Messiah in the Old Testament, and these prophecies were fulfilled in Jesus' life with 100% accuracy. Thank you so much for my eyeglass, my reading glass. Thank you. Thank you. And some of the, and actually you show him the word of God. The Old Testament predicted the Messiah's place of birth, Micah 5:2, Bethlehem. And when we read the New Testament, Jesus was born in Bethlehem. And remember, these prophecies written hundreds of years before Jesus was born. The Old Testament predicted that the Messiah will be born of a virgin, Isaiah 7:4. The virgin will be with the child and will call him Emmanuel. And the Old Testament predicted that the Messiah will be crucified, Psalm 22. A band of evil men have encircled me. They have pierced my hand and my feet. The Old Testament even predicted why the Messiah will come, his mission, Isaiah 53. He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. And we all have gone astray. Each one, went to his own way. And the Lord laid on him the iniquities of us all. Isaiah 53. The Old Testament actually predicted that the Messiah is divine. We read that in Isaiah 9. To us, a child is born. To us, a son is given. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. So we tell Muslims, wow, this is a very significant title. Because the Old Testament has many prophecies about one Savior God will send. And he came to be called the Anointed One, the Messiah, Daniel 9. And the prophets waited for the coming Messiah. And that's why the Jews told Jesus, are you the Messiah? Okay. And the Messiah is divine. This is very clear in the Old Testament. You remember Daniel. I believe Daniel 7. In my vision at night, I saw one like the Son of Man coming in the clouds of heaven. He approached the Ancient of Days, God, and was led to his presence. And all people from all nations worshipped him. And his kingdom will never be destroyed. He is the king of an eternal kingdom. Obviously, this one who looks like a Son of Man is more than just a man. Because he would be worshipped by all people from all nations, all languages will worship him. And his kingdom will never be destroyed, will last forever. Daniel 7. Wow. He's more than a man. So the Old and the New Testament predicted that the Messiah and Jesus Christ, he is called in the Quran, Al-Masih Isa, is human and divine, both. The Quran also gave Jesus the title, the Word of God. Just try to believe me. I studied the Quran in law school. I used to work as a lawyer in Egypt, and we had to study the Quran, and I studied the Quran all my life. The Quran clearly, explicitly gave Jesus the title, the Word of God, Kalimatuhu, his word. And we tell Muslims, wow, that's a common ground between us. Now, we tell Muslims, yes, we disagree about many major teaching and doctrines found in the Quran, different than the Bible. However, how about if we talk a little bit about what we agree about? And then we can talk about what we disagree, and perhaps our discussion and our search for what we agree about, maybe it will help us resolve some of our differences. Maybe. At least we don't have to fight all the time. You know, so we tell Muslims the Quran said Jesus is the word of God. A Muslim will say, oh, where? Surah 4, verse 171. And we tell him the Bible also clearly gave Jesus the title, the word of God. Revelation 19, he is dressed in a robe dipped in blood, and his name is the word of God. And of course, John 1. In the beginning was the word was with God, the word was God, and the word became flesh. So we tell Muslims, clearly the New Testament gave Jesus the title, the word of God, and I am glad we agree about that Jesus is the word of God. And Muslims will tell you, okay, so, okay, that's it. No, that's not it, because since the Bible gave Jesus the title, the word of God, and the Quran agrees Jesus is the only person in human history who is called the word of God, that means that Jesus is the perfect expression of God's mind and will, because he is the word of God. Now, your word reveal who are you, right? The word of God reveal who God is, right? Thank you for doing that. The rest of you are sleeping. This is a very exciting topic. I want you to engage. Your word reveal who are you. The word of God reveal who God is. And that's what Jesus said. John 14, he who has seen me has seen the Father. And your word come out from you, it can go all over the world, it accomplish many things. But your word is still in you, right? We tell Muslim that. And Muslims say, yeah. And that's what Jesus said, my Muslim friend. I in the Father, and the Father is in me. I and the Father, and the Father is in me. Jesus said that in John 14. And your word come out from you. Your word is still in you. You and your word are one. Right? You can't speak something and you tell me, no, that's not me. I just said that. No, that's you. You and your word are one. And that's what Jesus said. I and the Father are one. John 10 theory. Now, this is a very significant title. One time I was doing a satellite TV, and I mentioned that title. I was doing not a debate, a presentation with two PhD Muslim professors, the chief imam of Arizona, the chief imam of Los Angeles, satellite Arabic TV, broadcast to millions of Muslims. And I told them this is very significant titles. And I tell Muslims that this is very significant title. And usually Muslims tell me, no, you are taking that title far than it really means. I tell them, am I? No. This title emphasize the deity of Jesus Christ, because Jesus Christ himself is the word, and the source of the word is God. Thank you, God. This is, I'm not making that title to mean more than it is. And to prove it to you, according to one of the companion of Muhammad, who Muhammad said he is the most knowledgeable person about what God revealed to me, his name is Abdullah ibn Abbas. Abdullah ibn Abbas said, very significant, very reliable statement, acknowledged by all Muslims. He said that Yahya, the prophet Yahya, who is John the Baptist in the Bible, they call him Yahya, was the first to believe and confirm that Jesus is the word of God. And to express his belief, his bowing down to Jesus in his mother's womb was his expression of faith in Jesus, that he is the word of God. I told him, Prophet Yahya, according to Abdullah ibn Abbas, which is the most knowledgeable person of what God told Muhammad, admit with other Muslim theologians that the Prophet Yahya bowed down to Jesus to express his faith that Jesus is the Word of God. And of course, bowing down is a clear form of worship. And worship is due only to God. He told me, no. He was bowing down as a sign of respect. I told him, you must be kidding. Who are you? Are you a Catholic? Sign of respect? Bowing down, you are a Muslim for God's sake. You believe that bowing down is only to the Creator. Silence. And I told him, not only that. See, my job was to find the most important evidence in the Quran and according to the Muslim theologian that we can build a bridge and use that bridge as a stepping stone to the gospel. And I told him, not only that, but also one of the greatest Muslim commentator of the Quran, his Quran is all over the mosques in the world, all over the world. His name is Baydawi. He said, Jesus is called the Word of God because he is like the Book of God. And you tell me I am making more of that title than I should. Al-Baydawi said, Jesus is called the Word of God because he is like the Book of God. Don't you believe that the Book of God and the Word of God is eternal and uncreated and divine in essence? You need to think about the implication, what that title means. Because that title points to Jesus' divinity. Jesus is the perfect expression of God's character, and God communicated to us directly, personally, through his word, Jesus. The word became the man, Christ Jesus, who is born of the Virgin Mary. Now, I want you to know that it is good that we talk about that today. Why? Because every four persons living in the world today, one of them is a Muslim. And the Muslim population doubles every 20 years. And we have in America about 20 million Muslims. They are growing all the time. Hundreds of thousands of Muslims come to study. Hundreds of thousands come for medical help. Hundreds of thousands come to do business. Hundreds of thousands of Muslims come to stay because America is the best country in the world. They want to enjoy living in America. And maybe hundreds or thousands coming with bad intentions. And we trust the FBI and the CIA to find out who are there and arrest them and judge them. But our job is to be ready for divine appointments. Be ready for divine appointments. Most of the Muslims we won because I equipped the churches like you. God provided divine appointment. You can read some of those interesting emails. So we tell Muslims, Hebrew 1, in the past, God spoke to our forefathers at various times through the prophets. In these last days, God spoke to us through his Son. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being. That's who Jesus is. Okay, and Muslims usually tell you, oh, but God will come here to us. Hey, human, in this dirty earth, tell him, listen, we don't look at it that way. We look at it as, let me give you illustration. And that's what we've done in the book. We give them a lot of stories and the illustration. Let's say one of your family member is sick and you love that person. What would be the best way to communicate with that person? To send him a letter or go visit him yourself? Visit him. Do you blame God for being passionate in his love and being humble in his spirit. This is the glory of God in the Bible, that he is humble God. He's not so transcendent, removed from the suffering of his creation. No, he knew that humanity is sick with sin, and he personally came in the person of Jesus Christ to save us and to heal us. This is the God of the Bible. You know, I can say more, but I have to move on because I want to cover some ground. The Quran said, Jesus is a spirit from God. Believe me, try to imagine. That's what the Quran said. Jesus is a spirit from God. We tell Muslims, wow. This title supports our belief that Jesus is not creature made of dust, but he is the eternal spirit who took on human flesh. He is a spirit from God. Wow! That means that Jesus pre-existed before his miraculous conception, because his miraculous virgin birth, pre-existed. He's a spirit from God. Ooh, he's different than all other people or prophets. And that's what Jesus said. The Father himself loves you because you believed that I came from the Father. Right? This is John 16. I came from the Father and entered the world, and now I am leaving the world and going back to the Father. And John the Baptist said, the one who comes from above is above all. The one who comes from the earth speaks like the one who is from the earth. But the one who comes from heaven is above all. This is John 3, John the Baptist. So we tell Muslims, listen, we are really in some area, we are not too far. We need to think, examine the common ground. Because we believe that Jesus is united to God the Father in one spirit throughout eternity. And then he took an additional nature, a human nature, and he came to earth through the Virgin Mary, through the Holy Spirit, and he came and subjected himself to the will of the Father. He came as God's ambassador to do God's will. And he had two natures, divine and the human, united in one person. What is so difficult to understand about that? That's what happened. And again, he will tell you, a God will come to us. Tell him, listen, I'll give you another illustration. If you saw someone you love sinking in the ocean, sinking, 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 what would be his greatest need? Someone to throw to him a book of swimming instructions and tell him, try to swim. He's sinking. We are sinking in the mud of sin. Sin lives within us. We are captive to sin. We are blinded spiritually. We are separated from God. We are sinking. We are dying. Spiritually, physically, mentally, you name it. Sin is destroying us, and Satan is holding us captive. And God came and rescued us. And he can rescue you if you believe that he came through Jesus Christ. The Quran agrees with us that Jesus is born of a virgin. You know, if you get the book, I have a few copies of the book, 107. Jesus' miraculous conception is taught in the Quran. And also, of course, clearly in the Bible. So we tell Muslims, wow, why? Why Jesus is the only person in human history who is born of a virgin through the Holy Spirit, according to the Bible, and the Quran agrees. Why? I mean, God is not going to just decide for the fun of it, oh, let's have Jesus come from a virgin through the Holy Spirit. Without any deep significant reason. I mean, God doesn't do these things every day. Actually, this was the only exception to the normal order of procreation. Why? We ask Moses, why? Have you ever thought about it? Why? Muslims now thinking, because now they don't only have to think about what you believe, they are thinking about what they believe, what's recorded in the Quran. So tell them why God gave us this information. Actually, the Quran said to us that Jesus' miraculous birth was a sign God gave to all humanity. What kind of a sign is this? Even the virgin birth, nobody knows that it's a virgin birth. And the Quran said Mary, God preferred her and chose her above all the women of all creation. We tell Muslims why. Why the Quran said, behold, the angel said, O Mary, Allah has chosen thee above the women of all creation, of all nations. Why? The answer is easy, because she was the mother of the most perfect divine man ever walked the face of the earth. That's how she got God's favor, and God chose her and preferred her. Yes, according to Luke, she is highly blessed. I mean, we don't pray for Mary, to Mary, but she was extraordinary woman, extremely humble, extremely putting her faith in God. And she suffered to do God's will. Okay, why Jesus is the only one who was born of a virgin through the Holy Spirit? We tell Muslim, listen. Jesus is the divine Son of God who existed throughout eternity. If the eternal Son of God came in the likeness of man, he could not have been born of a father and mother. Because the life of the human race is passed through the male seed. But Jesus' coming must be the only exception to the normal order of procreation, because it was an entry. He pre-existed. So the spiritual sonship of Jesus to the Father explains the necessity of the virgin birth and gives the reason for it. And I tell Muslims that every time I speak to them. Actually, I said that on a satellite Arabic TV program that broadcasts to millions of Muslims in the Middle East with two PhD Muslim professors. I told them, listen, I know we disagree about major doctrines. I know. But how about can we just for a few minutes think about what we agree about? And they say, okay, well, what do you want to say? I told them, we agree that God is a spirit. God is everywhere. He sees everything. They said, okay. We agree that Jesus is a spirit from God, according to the Quran. And according to us, he is the eternal spirit who took on human flesh. And they said, okay, go on. What else do you want to talk about agreement? I said, we agree that Jesus is conceived through the Virgin Mary, through the power of the Holy Spirit, not through a human father. And they said, yes, we know that. It's in the Quran. I told them, okay. He is not related to any human father. Silence. And I said, then he must be related to God. If you object what Jesus said about himself, that's not what we say about him, that he is the Son of God. He said, I am the Son of God, in so many words in the New Testament. If you object that God is his father, then you tell me who his father could be. I did that in the satellite TV. Find him a father, please. The moderator started interfering. I said, no, they don't acknowledge. I said, no, please, don't answer. I am asking them. Silence. I told them, listen, doctors, according to the teaching of the Quran and the Bible, which we agree about, Jesus could not have been called anything more appropriately than the Son of God. And you call us blasphemous, for believing that Jesus is the Son of God. And you just misunderstand. The Quran actually misunderstood the sonship of Jesus to the Father. He explained it to be in a physical sense. And the Quran said, how can God have a son if he doesn't have a wife? Tell him, that's not what we believe about the sonship of Jesus. The sonship of Jesus is unique, eternal, spiritual sonship. Sonship, son of God, means he came from God. He has the same nature as God. That's why it's called son of, not a child out of a physical relationship between man and woman. No, son of, sameness of nature. That's why the Jews wanted to stone him when he said, I am the son of God. So we tell Muslims, listen, that's also what the Old Testament said. And in Isaiah 7:14. And that's what the angel said to Mary. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Luke 1. That's not something we make up. This is facts. You don't understand it. You need to take time in prayer and you need to spend time with God and think about the facts God gave you. And I can prove it to you more. And he said, go ahead, and we start talking more. And actually, I can tell you now, according to the Quran, this is page 111, according to the Quran and the Bible and everything Muhammad said, everyone is sinner. And actually, I went to a mosque one day, 1 week I was speaking in a few churches, and I had some time in between to kill, and I told them, where is the mosque? So I went to the mosque with my wife, and we had two bags, one in Arabic of my book and one in English. And I start giving the book to the people in the mosque. And the imam came to me. He was a big, tall one. I started praying more. And and he said, what are you doing? I told him, I am giving my book to my brothers, my Muslim brother, and can I sign a book for you? He said, what is this book? Let me, nobody leave. Let me see, what is this book? And they said, this is a Christian book. I told them, well, it's about God's love and salvation. How can you enjoy God's love, and how can you know you are going to heaven? He said, don't give me that. This is a Christian book. You are a Christian, and we believe that you are a blasphemer. I told him, if this is a way to treat a guest, I thought Muslims treat guests better than that. I'm coming here with goodwill, giving my book as a gift, which took me 5-6 years to write, because I love Muslims. He said, don't beat around the bush. Don't tell me that. You believe Jesus is God. This is blasphemy. I told him, only fanatic people, only fanatic Muslims yell and get angry and don't give the other person a chance to talk. Do you want to treat me like that? And America giving you the freedom to practice your faith and to talk about your faith? This is America. We are not in Saudi Arabia here. I can talk about my faith. Can you give me a chance, please? They told him, let him talk, let him talk. Thank you. According to the Quran and the Hadith, Hadith is what Muhammad said, and the Bible, everyone is sinner. That's what the Quran said clearly. That's what Muhammad said clearly. That's what the Bible said. Everyone is sinner. They said, okay. Everyone is sinner, except the prophets. I told them, no, all the prophets are sinner. Look. Page 113, Adam sinned, and the last relationship was God. Abraham sinned, Jonah sinned, Moses sinned. And of course, I listed many, many verses in the Quran and the Hadith. Muhammad sinned, but I didn't come to speak about Muhammad sin. No, I did not. I just came to tell you that the only one who exists, who can exist without committing one single sin is God. After 5 minutes, they said, we agree. And I told them, and according to the Quran and the Hadith, what Muhammad said and the Bible, Jesus was the only person who existed without committing one single sin. They said, where? I said, right here. Right here. Page. Hold on one second. Page 113. No, I'm sorry. This is the prophet. Page 111, right here. Jesus is the only one, according to Muhammad and the Quran, left without committing one single sin. The Quran described him to be a boy most pure, pure from sin, pure, faultless. Different translation to English. And they agree. And I told them, well, I am glad you agree. I'm glad a couple of you agree, and I'm glad you start realizing that because Jesus was the only person who was able to exist without committing one single sin, he must share the same pure essence and divine essence as God. And you call us blasphemous for believing that Jesus is more than a prophet, that he is God made manifest in the flesh? Don't you even want to know why Jesus was able to live without committing one single sin? And of course, everybody took the book, and half of them asked me to sign it. And we stayed, me and my wife, till 4 o'clock p.m., and it was, and I told them, let me tell you why. Jesus said, I and the Father are one, John 10 theory. Not one person, but one in essence and nature. Right? Since God the Father and Jesus the Son are one, it follows that the Son always does the will of his Father. Right? And that's what Jesus said in John 5. Whatever the Father does, the Son also does. And since God can never sin, it follows that Jesus can never sin. Because he is one with God. He never did anything independently outside of God's will and God's heart. Because he and God's nature. He never done anything independently according to his own will. So, because Jesus is one with God, the Father, he always did the absolute will of God, 100%. And that's why Jesus said, whatever the Father does, the Son also does. And he said, I always do what pleases him. John 8. No one can say that. I wish. If I can say that 24/7. But that should be our goal, that we connect with God, we unite with God, we deny ourselves, and we let Jesus control our life so we always in harmony with what God wants us to say and do. Remember that. Very important. Because the more we are united, the more we do God's will. It comes automatic even after a while. Okay. So we tell Muslims that's why Jesus was the only person who was able to live a sinless life. Now, according to the writing of the Muslim theologian, not only Jesus was sinless, all of them, of course, acknowledge this fact, but he was also able to cleanse the people from sin. Wow! So remember, this was my job, is to collect the evidence. Now, if you know my background, you will know why I did that. I used to work as a defense lawyer in my father's legal firm in Egypt. My grandfather also a defense lawyer 50 years, my father 50 years, my older brother judge in the Supreme Court. He used to be the chief judge of the Supreme Court in Egypt. So that's our family talking about evidence all the time since I was 7 years old. My father will take me to his office. So I'm trained always to think, to analyze, to collect evidence about anything. If this person saying the truth or not, where is the facts from the witnesses and all that. However, my problem is most of my clients in Egypt as a defense lawyer were criminals and drug dealers, and all of them were guilty. I never met an innocent client. They were guilty as hell. Horrible clients, you know. They don't care destroying people's lives with drugs. They don't care. And I had a problem because after I became born again, I wanted to talk to my friends, Muslim friends, about Jesus, because they noticed that I am different than them. And we play soccer, we go to the beach, Suez Canal, and we are friends. We eat together, we study together. But I got into trouble. I was attacked physically a couple of times. I was arrested. So my father told me, listen, this is not going to work in Egypt. You need to focus on your legal career, which I did for 2 years to make money, become successful and all that, make my father proud. And then God convicted me big time through Hebrew 11. I told God, what can I do? You know, I cry, I listen to Christian songs, I cry, and then I go sin again and help my drug dealers, and I cry again. I repented like hundreds of times every few months. And then finally, God told me, listen, Hebrew 11, I start reading Hebrew 11. I will go to church once a month, and I read the Bible, you know, try to read the Bible once every week, and then I read Moses was born and raised to be a prince in Egypt. But Moses preferred to leave Egypt, suffer affliction with the people of God, rather than to enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. And he considered the reproach, the suffering of Christ, far richer, greater treasure than all the treasures of Egypt. And God, because I used to tell God, what can I do? This is my job. I can't leave my father. I love my father. I can't leave him. He's raising me to manage his legal firm and manage his property and to take over. And that's family business. I cannot leave. And what else I do? I don't know how to do anything else. And God said, leave Egypt. 1980. Came to America, worked in a gas station, busboy, dishwasher, waiter for 17 years, studied law, went to UCI, graduated, and before I started practicing as a lawyer again, God brought my wife. And my wife told me, listen, God brought us together not to get rich. I am an ex-Muslim. I want the Muslim people to know Jesus. You have a calling. I told her, yeah, but nobody cares about my calling. The pastors don't care. That was 1992, 93, 94. And she said, doesn't matter if the pastors care or not. We need to start praying so God can guide us how we can fulfill our calling, helping Muslims know Jesus. I said, you need to pray. I told her, I don't need to pray about this one. This is very clear. God wants me to be a lawyer. I am a lawyer. And she said, no, you are a servant of God. I was praying that God will give me a servant. Pray. I started praying. To my surprise, God told me, your wife is right. Because my question to God, I need to use my mind to do something important. I used to have a job in the government at that time, which I was not using my mind much. Yeah, it's funny, but that was the truth. And God told me, I told God, what can I do? I need to use my mind. I need to work as a lawyer. Get cases, win cases, and God said, you are right, you need to use your mind, but use it for me, not to make your family proud and make a lots of money. That's not why I called you out of Egypt. And don't be disappointed and frustrated because you've been lonely and poor for 20 years. Moses also was a shepherd for 4 years. Keep walking by faith. Your wife is right. I told him, how about you don't want me to use my mind? God said, love me with all your mind. Isn't it the greatest commandment? I told him, yeah. And he said, oh God, what can I do? How can I love you with all my mind? I love you. And God said, no, you can do something good. You can do something unique. You can do a good research, analyze the most important issues, collect the evidence and present Jesus in the most understandable, the most attractive, the most acceptable, the most convincing way to educated Muslims. Write a book. And of course, American people helped me to edit it, you know, and to put it in the computer and to print it. American people has been helping me since the beginning, since 1994, especially Pastor Chuck Smith. I miss him so much. Anyway, we tell Muslims, and that's not even it. There is a lot more. Is it a lot more? Yeah. According to the Quran, you can read page 119, God is the only one who can create living beings. That's what the Quran said explicitly. And according to the Quran, Jesus had the ability to create birds the same way God created Adam, by his breath. Wow! Why? And according to the Bible, God created through the word, through Jesus. According to the Quran, God is the only one who can raise the dead. Well, according to the Bible, Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead, and he told Martha, I am the resurrection and life. He who believes in me will live even after dying. John 11. And we tell Muslims, isn't it that something? Can you start acknowledging the uniqueness of Jesus? John 5. For just as the Father raises the dead and gives them life, so the Son gives life to whom he ever he pleases. Okay, according to the Quran, no one can have the ability to know the unseen. Things are not seen by the human eyes. Muhammad said, I cannot know what is unseen. According to the Quran and the Bible, Jesus is the only person who had the ability to know the unseen. And on and on and on, I cannot tell you everything. And I want to finish with this last thought. We tell Muslims, listen, even though Muhammad stated in the Quran, and the Quran stated that Jesus is just a prophet, yes, I know. However, Muhammad and the Quran and the Bible confirm and the Bible explain, but the Muhammad and the Quran attributes to Jesus characteristics and the traits and the abilities and titles that are collective evidence that demand the conclusion that he is more than a prophet. Divine traits and titles and characteristics that only belong to God. Maybe God allowed these facts to exist in the Quran, my Muslim friends, so you can have a complete relationship with him and acknowledge who Jesus is. Because all these facts are explained more in the Bible, especially the pages of the New Testament. All these unique features and titles and characteristics and traits and the abilities in the life of Jesus, not because he is clever or he has great character, but because of the will of God. And they all harmonize and find their meaning and their significance in the two fundamental doctrines about Jesus. Jesus is unique because he is the Son of God. He is God made manifest in the flesh. He is he who said he is. He is the Savior of the world. And many Muslims tell you now, what do you mean? Why Jesus is the Savior? Explain this to me. See, many Muslims don't know, don't understand. They don't understand the Bible. The Bible never been presented to them in a way they can understand. You thought they understood and then they rejected it. Ah, not the Muslims. Why? Because the church leaders in America and pastors never invested their time or their effort or their thinking, even their money, and sharing Jesus effectively with Muslims. Do you know that the church leaders in America spend trillions of dollars every year on so many things, and they don't even spend 1%, I challenge you, 1% of their time or budget to share Jesus effectively with Muslims. It's a tragedy. I have a radio program. I have a radio program that through K-Wave 13 minutes a week, and I am struggling to broadcast my radio program and other Christian radio stations. They want so much money. And I tell them, why you want so much money? You don't have anything that equip your audience to share Jesus effectively with Muslims. I got it. I am winning Muslims to Christ. You don't know of any minister in America that's winning all these Muslims to Christ. Give me time in the radio. He said, give us what we want. Money, lots of money. Those are the leaders of the media, satellite TV and radio. Lots of money. If you have lots of money, you pay, we'll take your program. Even if you repeat the same Bible study that has been repeated hundreds of times about having faith in God. So what? Let's repeat. Give us your Bible study. Give us money. Give us your Bible. That's the Christian media in America. It's a tragedy. Okay, now, you want to know why Jesus is our only Savior? Muslims tell you, of course I want to know. Many Muslims are seeking the truth. Why? Because they have been killing each other. So they want to know if there is anything better out there, if there is a loving family out there, if there is good teachers, good teaching that unite us and gives us peace and assurance of going to heaven. They are confused. It's a tragedy. So many Muslims are open to the gospel. If you approach them the right way and give them the Bible in a way that answers their questions. Okay. So we tell Muslims, listen, we are all separated from God because of sin. We need a savior. We have a problem, and the problem is acknowledged in the Quran and by Muhammad. Sin is an integral part of the human nature. All manners of iniquities dwell in the human heart. Envy, greed, jealousy, selfishness, lust, you name it. It is in our human heart. We have a sinful nature. The human body is captive to the power of sin. Almost everybody is selfish, but some people are 100% selfish and other people 90% selfish. And others are 50% selfish. A problem. Sin has a vicious control over the human within each person. The human body is the playground of sin. All humans are captive to the power of sin and its ongoing temptation. Any one of us, if we are not watching, can sin. Small sin or big sin? It depends how much you are not watching. We have a problem. That's why we have so many problems in the world, and people killing each other all over the world, and people fighting, and even people in the same church are not loving each other. We have a problem. Okay. If there is a solution in the Quran, no whatsoever. The Quran tells you, obey the law. That failed already in the Old Testament. Everybody failed to obey the law. But can I tell you about what Jesus done? He done something more than the prophets and the law were able to do. What was that? I'll tell you. Jesus is the only one who is pure from sin. He came in the likeness of sinful man, Romans 8, and he condemned the sin in the flesh. What does that mean? He condemned sin in the flesh. What does that mean? His divine nature guaranteed his victory against sin by resisting Satan's temptation and by not committing one single sin. Jesus won the battle against sin in its own dwelling place, the human body. Brilliant. In the flesh, he condemned sin in the flesh. He beated the power of sin in its own dwelling place, the human body. He won the battle on our behalf. As a human, because he had divine nature. And that's why the incarnation. See, there is a reason for everything. For the Trinity, incarnation, everything. So we tell Muslim, listen. The good news is in the gospel. The gospel means good news. The moment you put your faith in Jesus, that he came and died on the cross to pay the penalty for your sin, the moment you repent, repent means simply you tell God from all your heart, God, I don't want to do the things that you don't want me to do. Give me the ability, God. And I want to do everything that you want me to do, God. Give me the ability to do everything you want me to do. That's repentance. And the moment you repent and open your heart, what Jesus said, I stand at the door and knock, door of your heart. If anyone open the door, I will come in. I tell him, my Muslim friend, the good news is, if you do that, Jesus will come to live within you through his spirit, and you will enjoy the fruit of his victory against Satan and against sin. Jesus said in John 8, anyone who sin is a slave to sin. And he further said, John 8:36, if the Son set you free, you will be free indeed. So Jesus came to save you and me from the love, captivity, and power of sin. If you want to be free, and be careful. And that's what Jesus said. The Son of Man came to destroy the devil's work. The devil's work is tempt people with sin, give them momentary pleasure or success or money or flesh pleasures, and hold them captive and drag them down. Sin destroys people's lives mentally, emotionally, spiritually, and physically. And financially, even though he makes them rich in the beginning. But in the end, finances, well, it's not going to mean anything because they are not going to use it for God's glory. So it's nothing. It means nothing. They leave it behind. They lost everything, including their eternal life. So Jesus said, if you do not believe that I am the one who claimed to be, you will die in your sin. There is no any other way out. We only can be liberated from the power of sin through Jesus' presence within us. Now, I still can sin if I choose to, but I don't have to. I can forgive. I can love. I can live for God. I can do God's will. But before I am captive, I am blind, I am helpless. Not only that, but my Muslim friend, we know that God is just. And he requires payment for everything wrong we've done. Everything wrong we've done against him, or against people that he created and loved, or even against ourselves, because our lives is not our own. God owns our lives. So, my Muslim friend, Jesus came and he made the payment. He paid our debt sin on the cross. And the good news is, my Muslim friend, good news I have for you today. The moment you put your faith in Jesus, you become united with him, and everything wrong, your sinful nature, self-sinful person done or will do, will be paid for through the sacrifice of Christ. And we have an awesome verse in Romans 6. Since we have been united with Christ in his death, we know that our sinful man has been crucified with him. It's done. And of course, God told us that he reconciled us through Christ. So the good news is, when you believe in Jesus Christ, that he died to pay the penalty for your sins, and repent and invite him to your heart, you become united with Christ, and you share in and benefit from his death. And you will experience the forgiveness of God for all of your sins within your heart and soul. I remember 1976, February 17, when I put my faith in Jesus and I repented and I became born again. I actually ran in the street. I started running in the street. I was so happy. I felt like the guilt of sin was removed and I felt fresh, born again, and have peace with God, and life became new. Jesus came to save you and me from paying the penalty for all of our sins. Not only that, the third good news, this is the last one. Jesus came, and by rising from the dead, he conquered death. He not only paid the worst consequence for our sin, death, separation from God, and torture, but he actually reversed the worst consequence of our sin and rose from the dead, ascended to heaven, and is alive today. And when you put your faith in him, my Muslim friend, the same living Christ, living and life-giving Spirit of Christ, who is in heaven now, because I didn't forget, but I don't have time to share with you everything. According to the Quran, Jesus ascended to heaven and he's alive today. And he's coming back again. You know, I did not share with you everything because there is no time. I'm hoping you get the book. I have, I think, 12 copies or 13 copies left. The same living and the life-giving Spirit of Christ, who's eternal, will come to live within you and will give you the assurance. Do you want to know that you are going to heaven? My Muslim friend, put your faith in Christ. Open your heart, repent, and the same living eternal Spirit of Christ will come to live within you and will give you the assurance that heaven is your home and your destiny. You will not be afraid to die. You're going to be, you know that you are going to be with God forever. You die only physically. And that's why my Muslim friend Jesus said, because I live, you also will live. How can Jesus say that? That's why Jesus said, that's even Romans 6, because we have been united with him in his death, we will be raised with him as he was raised. Romans 6. I can read to you the exact words. Since we have been united with him in his death, we will also be raised to life as he was. This is one translation. Why? Because we are united. You can't walk to San Francisco, but if you jump it in an airplane, boo, you can fly. You can't know that you are going to heaven or you can't have a place in heaven. But if you are in Jesus, you are already in heaven. And you will know that. That's why Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Jesus came, the divine, human, Jesus Christ came as the man, Jesus Christ, to bridge the gap that exists between heaven and earth and to reconcile a holy God with a sinful man. Now, we use, some people say, tell me, Samy, some, I would call them fanatic Christians, say, Samy, you use verses from the Quran. I tell them, oh, you bet you. I use evidence. God wants me to use my mind, and I use evidence because they tell me, is it legitimate? I was doing a radio program, and one of the audience told me, is it legitimate? I told them, well, It is legitimate, as it is legitimate to use any pro-Christian quote in any respected book or from any leader. And you can make the analogy that it is not necessary to agree with everything Abraham Lincoln did or said before you can quote from his profound speech. If you ask the question, is truth any less true if it is found somewhere else than the Bible? No, truth is truth, wherever it may be found. And the people usually understand, well, truth to be taught can be learned easier through truth already known. Right? So we use that. Now, I am praying, you can pray for me. I am praying that instead of winning a few thousand Muslims to Christ. Now, I was in Israel teaching at Calvary Chapel Bible College and another seminary. Me and my wife, we got invitation for lunch and to speak at the biggest seminary, Bethlehem Seminary. And the president was so excited to meet me. I told him, thank you for lunch. It was great. And he said, no, thank you. And I told him, what did I ever do to you? He said, you gave us 2,000 copies of your book in Arabic. Actually, we did not give him anything. I did not tell him that. I was waiting for lunch to be over. It was a lunch buffet. And after lunch, I told him, I don't remember I gave you 2,000 copies of the book. He said, you did. What happened is God provided the money to print 5,000 copies in Arabic in Israel. We did not know who took the book. We tried to give permission and they printed the book in Europe, if possible, Africa, the Middle East, and we don't know who takes the book. So we don't try to control the book because I feel like God wants us to spread it everywhere. I even give it free to Christians many times, especially students. Anyway, he told me, well, you know what happened? I told him what happened. He said, we took 2,000 copies of your book and we gave them to Palestinian Muslims in the West Bank. You know what happened? I told him, please tell me. And he said, we won 100 Muslims to Christ. And I spoke at the Missionary Alliance Church in Jerusalem and the pastor said, no, we won over 100 Muslims to Christ. And we have a problem because the Christians don't love Muslims. They don't trust them. They don't want to hire them. They don't want to marry them or invite them to their homes. So we know that your wife is ex-Muslim and we want you to come help us establish bridges with Muslims, you and your wife, help us to love them and help us to win more Muslims to Christ and give us more books. You know, that's why we invited you. Now, my prayer is that I will share all this information and a lot more that I have written down through as many radio stations as possible and through satellite TV in America. And if possible, if I have more financial support, I want to share it through more satellite Arabic TV to the Middle East. Now, it's not easy. It's going to take prayer, and it's going to take more financial support. Now, we have enough financial support. I quit my government job a few years ago, and we have enough financial support to continue doing the ministry as much as we can. We are winning Muslims to Christ all the time, but my dreams and my goals is instead of winning a few thousand, I am 6 years old now. Maybe I have 10 more years left. I don't think I'm going to live like Charlie did. I'm not counting on it. I'm not counting on it. I say maybe 10 more years I will be strong in the ministry. I want to be able, before I get sick and die, to win a few million Muslims to Christ. To equip a few million believers in America and overseas, and to share this information with 50, 60 million Muslims and win a few millions of them to Christ. Then I will die happy with a big smile on my face. Now, if God put it in your heart, above your tithing, if God is blessing you and above your tithing, you want to help me accomplish that goal, when you get the book, or you can write one check to Glad News for Muslims, or you can become a monthly financial partners. I have a small team of financial partners. Most of them donate $15 a month above their tithing. Some generous, they donate $40. Some rich, they donate $70. A few donate $70, $80, $100. But most of them donate $15. If you can do that, I encourage you to do that, because I feel like God is giving us something extremely unique. Me and my wife, God gave us the passion, the calling, the experience, the education, the evangelistic tools, and God already giving us the fruits. All we need to do is to do more of it. But my faith now, I want to use Christian media. I want to, and the only way to do it is through prayer and the financial support. And pray for me, and if you can do something on my behalf, do it. You know, don't think that I am the one who is doing the ministry. I am doing the ministry and winning many Muslims to Christ because of believers like you that God involved, whether prayer or financial support or making phone calls. Like, I made a phone call a week ago with Calvary Chapel Komomai, Pastor Bill Stonebreaker radio ministry. And I told the manager, forgot his name, the manager of the Jake, I think, I told them, I am willing to donate to your ministry if you broadcast my radio program, 13 minutes a week. He did not seem very interested. And I told the Bill a couple of years ago, he did not seem interested. But, so I am praying, and I went, you know, trying, and you can pray with me, you can help, whatever God enable you to do, whether phone call or financial support or prayer, whatever. I just feel like the more American Christians are involved, the more Muslims come to Christ. I am not the one who brings these Muslims to Christ, believe me. I am not the one who did the book in 11 languages and printed it in 5,000 copies in Israel and in Europe and in North Africa. I am not the one. There are American Christians who said, we want to help, we want to do. We got like $10,000 seven, 8 years ago, and we done the book in Farsi. I was praying, God, where do I spend? How I spend this $10,000? God said that, send it to Colorado Springs to be translated to Farsi. I got an email. My father is Iranian and was raised in the Muslim religion. When I got hold of your book, Glad News, God Loves You, My Muslim Friend in Farsi, I was so excited to share it with him. About a month later, he couldn't stop telling me how much he loved the book. He finally understood, see, Muslims don't understand the difference between the Quran and the Bible. I am so thankful for your book. I know it has answered so many of his questions, giving him clarity. I am blessed to say he considers himself a Christian now. So we are winning Muslims to Christ through the body of Christ. If God called you, now I have maybe 14 copies left, including my copy. I don't want to go home with any one of them. And when you buy a book, you help us to give free book. More money coming to our ministry, more books given to Muslims. So try to get the book. Don't write the check for me. Write it to Glad News for Muslims. And if it's a book and donation, write in the memo, book and donation. But let's pray. I am excited because I feel like God started the work, so I'm relaxed. I'm not under pressure at all. I feel God started the work, and God is the one who is going to guide more American Christians to help us continue the work. Last Sunday, I shared at One Love Ministries, and God blessed the presentation, and many people took the book. They said, we're going to send it overseas. And so God is always doing the ministry through Christian Americans, and I'm excited to be here with you today. And let's pray. The first prayer I want to pray is, If you never receive Jesus in your heart, if you never open your heart to Jesus and invited him personally, this is personal, to enter your heart. If you never repented, if you never told God, God, I want to do whatever you want me to do, today is a good day to tell God, thank you for Jesus, God. Thank you that he came and he died on the cross and paid the penalty for all of my sins, everything wrong I done. Jesus, come into my heart. I believe in you that you are my savior from paying the penalty for my sins. If you open your heart to Jesus, if you put your faith in him right now, you can raise your hand and we'll just pray for you. You can just raise your hand if you prayed this prayer. Raise your hand. Okay, the second prayer is, if you are defeated by anything, anything that you know God does not want you to do, or anything you know that God wants you to do and you don't do, if you are defeated by sin repeatedly, a lot, today is a good day to tell Jesus, Jesus, come live in my heart and in my life and to control my life, God. Jesus, I want to die for my self-centered life. And I want to be Christ-centered. I want you to take control and be Lord of my life. Life is short, Jesus. I want you to take over and to enable me to say no to sin and to say yes to God and to do your will, God, in my short life. Third prayer is, now if you pray this prayer, you can raise your hand. Yeah, thank you. There is no reason to be embarrassed. We are in church, for God's sake. And no one is looking. We are. The third prayer is, pray a prayer with faith. God, use me, God. Use Calvary Chapel Windward. Use us, God. But you pray it personally. Use me. I pray this prayer every day, all the time. Use me, God, to help so many people. I pray to help multitudes, millions of Muslims enjoy your love and salvation, God, and spend the eternity with you. God, use me in a powerful way to accomplish many of your eternal purposes and send the people to heaven. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen. Forgot to tell you, I have about 95 radio program here. I have two of them. If you want to get them, thank you for inviting me. God bless you and use your life powerfully.